Welcome to Mesa Desert Music. I'm your host, Craig Buchanan, and today I have Eddie Brewer with us. He is a man who comes from many musical backgrounds, multiple bands, and we're going to discuss all of the things that he's doing and some of the newer things that he's got coming with maybe a special song. Is that right, Eddie?
Yes, sir. Yes, Craig.
All right. Well, I like to start off my interviews with the same question for everybody, so I'm going to ask you that question. What started you on your path into music?
So, actually, I started taking piano lessons when I was like 4 years old. And I've been going to the same piano teacher for 21 years now.
You want to name check them?
Yeah, Oscar Ellis. Yeah, yeah. Oscar, you're awesome. Yeah, nice. So he's really guided me on a lot of this stuff, especially piano. And so I've learned a lot from him.
And I'm assuming it was a parental thing like that got you into the piano, but what kept you interested in it and playing it?
Well, there were some years I took off, you know. So, you know, I was playing piano, and then I started playing guitar when I was 10. Started taking some lessons from some, I don't even remember those dudes' names because I would be with them. There's one guy, Kelly. No name checks. Kelly is a good name check. He's great. But so I was always just really into guitar, really into piano. Started writing some songs when I was like 13, was writing some guitar songs. And then, just from there, just kind of stuck with it. And then I got back into piano. I mean, it was on and off for me, but I really got into piano, I think, when I was probably 15 or 16. And I was always learning classical stuff, and I asked my teacher, Oscar, I was like, hey, man, you got any jazz? I was like, because, like, I love jazz, but, like, this classical stuff is kind of killing me. And he was like, I wish you would have told me that a long time ago because that's what I specialize in. And so that's kind of funny. I don't know how I didn't run that past him, but so then I started working on songs like Fly Me to the Moon and learning how to improv and do stuff like that. So, yeah, he's really been my mentor through all of it.
So those are early songs that you wrote when you were an angst-ridden 13-year-old, I assume.
Yeah.
What kind of music was that?
More funny. Yeah, I had like an anti-ex song called Conniving Whore. So that was not a good one.
A beautiful love ballad.
Yeah, it was a love ballad. And I actually played it for her. And it was weird because I think she was more into me after I played it for her. She got a laugh. That was my teen angst anti-ex song. And then there was like, actually, I was kind of digging some like more just like melodic stuff when I was 13 too. I was like really digging like some Spanish guitar and stuff like that. Just a lot of different music out there. I definitely have not written any Conniving Whore song since, but, you know.
Will there be any in the pipelines?
No. You know, I think maybe someday I'll develop it a little bit more.
Well, how about this then? We're talking about songwriting. You talked about when you were younger. Obviously, when I wrote when I was younger, the songs were not that great.
Yeah.
Just be honest.
Yeah.
It's a learning curve. So for those unfamiliar with any of your work now, could you pick three of your personal favorites that you've written over the whole period of time? I'm assuming there'll be newer things, but what would be your three favorite songs that you've wrote and why?
Man, I guess that's really hard. Wow, that's a really hard question. I really like, I love Howl off of our Despots album because it's got some jazz flavors in it, and it's got piano in it, and I think it was just like a really, it was inspired by Allen, I think it was Allen Ginsberg, Zach, our rhythm player, he he wrote, he wanted to write something that was attributed to the beat poets. So he brought me the poem, Howl, and he said, hey man, like, let's do something with this. And he showed me a riff that he wrote, and I got super inspired. And that's what, I really like how it was very collaborative. So that me and Zach got together and we were just juiced on it. And then we were just, there's a line in it, what a wicked web we weave. And that was one that he brought to the table. And we were just really bouncing ideas off of each other. And it was just so much fun. And then, and recording that song was a lot of fun too, because I was learning some stride piano at the time, some like kind of Fats Waller stuff, which is like an early 1930s stride player. So I do these kind of walk-ups at the beginning that the stride players were doing, but I wanted to make it very like dark and jangly too. Yeah. So, but jazzy as well. So I was trying to really incorporate all of that and all their ideas and make it one big mesh. And then Danny comes in with this like shredding, just, you know, like rock and roll guitar in the middle. So we just have all these elements that we all brought together.
That song to me seems almost theatrical. With the three parts, the in, the middle, and the out. It's like it kind of tells a story. And that outro part, the piano on the outro part specifically, has been the one that I've always enjoyed the most in the song. It's a great song, but if we're talking about the parts, the outro part is loose. It kind of, it feels like something's happening in the story, and it's kind of coming apart a little bit, not in a bad way, you know, the context of the story. And I just love that, like you said, it's jangly. It just seems very loose. Was that deliberate?
Yeah. So there was, so actually, there's like this little diminished chord lick thing that I do. And, I really wanted it to kind of like fall apart, freeform type thing. And, I just remember I really wanted it to end on like, I just wanted it to just kind of go down. I wanted it to build up and fall back down, and also to have some like tension, I guess, and some relief in the song. So, I think that whole song was just like, my vision of it was always that like you're kind of in Whitechapel, London, with like Jack the Ripper and a bunch of werewolves, and you're a beast coming out
in the fog.
Yeah, in the fog, and just, and with the whole icy fear in your eyes and stuff like that. Just, that was just a fun song just in general to write. Like that whole album just has some really good, like funny songs and then really good. So it's like light on some of it, but then some of it's like really messed up, like messed up lyrics. So, it was a fun album, and all those guys are just awesome. Zach and Danny and Steve and Mark are just all, you know, I mean, me and Danny have been at it at this group for 5 years now, you know? Wow. And so,
under the title, The Despots.
Wow. Yeah. So, I mean, we didn't start recording until like, I think like, you know, 3 or 4 years in. So, and you know, that we had some different players, and we were just trying to get everything adjusted. But you know, having that album come out was just really a lot of fun for me and Danny, and we like recording. It's a ton of fun. So
I did ask for three. I'm not going to push you for three, but
is there
maybe another one that jumps out to you as one of the things that you're personally fond of that you've written?
I really liked Angels as well, because it's kind of like a polka beat, and it's very like, I was kind of going for like an outlaw Spanish mariachi thing with it. And I love the lead lick in it that Danny plays. And I just like the whole storytelling of it. It's like, how it's like a personal narrative of a dude basically going after a chick and her new lover, because he's, you know, she dumped him. So So it's really dark. Yeah, she's like, yeah, so that's where it evolved, you know, from the beginning, you know, and developed into this sick and twisted fantasy.
The circle of life.
Yeah, yeah, it was fun, and it was cool because I think that you know, we were kind of messing around with some of the licks and some of the chords, and the song kind of just writes itself, in my opinion. Like, you know,
is it a collaborative process for you?
Yeah, there's definitely collaboration, and there's definitely talking about things and testing things and strangling each other. Not just kidding. There's no strangling, but
only in the songs,
only in angels. And so I think that it's a lot of fun, you know, being able to be with guys that are just great musicians, like all the guys in our group. I mean, Steve's so diverse. Mm-hmm. He can play electric and stand up and switch between the two. And really, he just does what's best for the song. And then with Danny, you know, the collaborative process is awesome because, you know, he's open and he's willing, and then we're honest with each other too about what we like. And sometimes, you know, it's brutal honesty, and sometimes we don't want to hear it, but we get through it.
Stings a little.
Yeah, it stings a little, but we get through it together, which I really like. So,
So we were talking earlier about playing a song from the Despots album.
Mm-hmm.
Which one were we going to go with?
We were going to go with Daytona, which is my third favorite song.
Is it really?
Yeah, it actually is, because it's super funny and bluesy, and yeah, it's a fun song.
All right, well, let's hear that right now.
I don't know, but it's
And that was Daytona off the Despots' debut album. I've got Eddie Brewer with us. We're talking a little music, and right now I'm going to mix it up. I have a random question generator in front of me. Eddie doesn't know what's coming, nor do I, to be honest with you. You just click a button and it gives you a random question. Some might be goofy, some might be dark, who knows? But Eddie, you ready?
I am ready.
He can't even see the screen,
guys. I'm ready, Eddie. All yes, right. Let's do this.
First question. What issue will you always speak your mind about?
Oh, God. My issues?
Eddie issues.
My problems.
All right. We'll go to the
next
one.
Got a lot of them.
We're not going to elaborate here. If you had to change your name, what would you change it to?
Oh, man. I would change it to Freddie Bauer.
Okay. What's your favorite piece of clothing you own?
My favorite piece of clothing is my hand-me-down leather jacket.
It's a badass jacket if it's the one you wore when you showed up today.
It is. It's some random dude's jacket. He gave it to my friend, and my friend said you should have this. So there I don't know whose jacket it is.
Thank you, random dude.
Thanks, dude.
Random question. Who inspires you to be better?
Oh, God. Norm MacDonald.
There you go. What is one of your favorite smells?
Oh, man. Oh, God. Oh, jeez. I like the smell of coffee.
Have you ever saved someone's life?
Oh, God, no. God, I've probably ruined more lives than I've saved.
Going back to that song we talked about.
Yep, just ruining lives.
Do you speak anything other than English?
I speak idiot a lot. Just English.
Would you rather be stuck on a broken ski lift or a broken elevator?
Well, I guess it depends if it was by myself. If there is a hot chick. Because then I would totally love to be on a ski lift or an elevator. She's like, hey, is this the wrong time to hit on you?
All right, we're going to go a little dark here now.
Oh, yeah. Let's go dark.
What's the most disturbing song someone could play while having sex?
Oh, man. Oh, God. Mary Had a Little Lamb?
Its fleece was white as snow. If there's a hell, do you think you're going there?
Oh, God. Yeah. Oh, Jesus. I'm trying to repent. Don't send me down there.
All right. If you were to film a new horror movie, what would the plot be?
Oh, dude, actually, I have been thinking about this a lot, actually. I think it would be cool to do a movie based on the Hungarian suicide song because it's an actual song that has the most suicides attached to it. And so
I think in real life,
like it's a real song in real life. It has the most suicides attached to it. And it was made in Hungary. And I think it'd be cool to make a horror movie where, a detective's going and investigating all the deaths. And then it turns out that it's an apparition.
So it's like a haunted song.
A haunted song.
So it's like The Ring, but in music.
But set in the 1930s.
Specifically.
Whenever that song was made. It was made sometime.
In what country?
In Hungary.
That's where you're going to set the movie. See, we're going way off on
movies. Wait. No, wait, probably not. Because I can't speak. I only speak one language. We just discussed this.
Come on.
Oh, God.
Last disturbing question. You may have already answered this. Which serial killer do you find the most fascinating?
Serial killers are my thing. So the vampire of Dusseldorf, he was a serial killer, and I think It was like the 1930s because he got his head chopped off. It was right before the guillotines were like done with. And he, I actually wrote a song about it called The Vampire of Dusseldorf with my country group. And it's actually about, so he would cut people open to listen to their blood gush out. And that's why they called him the Vampire of Dusseldorf. And he ended up, before he got his head chopped off, he asked them, "Will I be able to hear my blood gushing ear to ear that would give me the pleasure of all pleasures?"
It got dark.
Right? Yeah.
It got dark.
Yeah, yeah.
I think we need to move it back into the music because I'm getting a little scared.
Well, it is almost Halloween, so that's totally...
It's true, it's
true.
Do
you feel the fear?
Oh, no.
Yes.
Let's go back into the music then. So we've talked first songs, we've talked some of your favorite songs. What was your first live performance like?
Oh, man. So this might be cheating, but I've always kind of been doing live performances since I was younger because I've always done recitals. But I guess the first live performance singing, I was actually in Utah, singing a song for a bunch of these families of my friends. And it was a cover of Third Eye Blind, Jumper, I think, or Semi-Charmed Life. One of those two
songs.
Let's
play that song right now. I'm just kidding.
And it was like really nerve-wracking. I could feel my belly shaking. I could feel all that, but I've always been into some performing stuff. My parents were always really good about getting me involved in stuff like that. I have it a little easier than most people do.
How old were you
when I first performed?
Mm-hmm.
First recital I did was when I was 4. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Four. So it's no new thing.
Yeah. Well, that's a little different because it's just playing keys. And I'm pretty sure I just played 3 and I was like, dun, 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 dun. And then everybody's like, oh, great. But when I was singing, what I started to do, because I knew it would get me better if I wanted to be in a live situation, as I started playing in front of my friends to kind of warm myself up to it and playing at parties, stuff like that. Me and Danny would always do that. We would always go to parties and just rock out together and play some songs that we were working on, improvise, do stuff like that. It was a lot of fun. So that kind of eased us into all of it too. But I remember being on stage, just some of the adrenaline rush of the first performances. And I still get that. Like, it's still really nerve-wracking. It's like going up there and just being like, and I usually just look out at the crowd and I just kind of take inventory of who's out there. And if there's nobody out there, I still try to take inventory on the 2 people that are out there. So, it's nerve-wracking for sure sometimes, but it's fun.
When it comes to either watching or writing, what's more important? Is it the music, the words, or the show?
Oh, man. I'm always kind of, I'm always playing around with some of that stuff in my head. Lately I've really been digging country. So I've really been digging the words. And writing the chords and stuff is sometimes really gets me excited too, just trying to find clever ways to move the song. I guess the theatrics when you're out performing is super important too, getting people involved and interested, because if you have all this cool stuff that you've written and you can't get people involved in it, then I guess it's like a little bit of a waste. So I guess, there's always that balance of having something having something fun to watch, mm-hmm. but at the same time having substance.
Yeah.
So that you're not just, so that's not just a bunch of unharnessed energy, I guess.
True. True. So you mentioned country, and that's a thing you've been like getting into a lot lately.
Mm-hmm.
You recorded a song here this evening that you'd probably say is in that vein, right? You said you took some influence from the Hank.
Yeah. I really love those old recordings of just Hank Williams and his guitar, and him just kind of being a little bit more on the intimate side of just playing something a little bit like more vulnerable lyrically and whatnot. And I mean, like, I've got a jazz group in town. I've got people that are in the country that I play with. I really like just learning, that's what I love about the Despots too, is that we're always playing different, like, kind of jazzy, kind of mm-hmm. country, kind of rock and roll. But, you know, collaborating with people, just, you learn a lot. Them teaching you and you teaching them, and just learning different things and just how other people's processes is kind of nice and kind of humbling, because a dude that I'm working with lately, Jimmy Davini, I'm just like learning so much from him, you know, and mm-hmm. Some of the guys like in town, Josh Lee, I'm just like learning like the Nashville number system. That's awesome stuff. And it kind of correlates with the jazz number system too, which I didn't realize. And just learning different tags and stuff like that. I mean, it's really awesome just having people, you know, that are just willing to work with you. So, yeah.
Well, let's check out that song that you recorded.
Yeah, absolutely. My name is Eddie Brewer. This is a song I wrote called Nightmares.
These dreams have been taking me from my home. When I go sleep, I pray for my soul. I wake, the room shakes, dark shadows pour. Oh Lord, nightmares no more. These dreams show me lovers that I've never known. The shadow of death grins under his cloak. I used to hear crickets, but now I'm alone. Oh Lord, I don't want these nightmares no more. These dreams have been taking me from my daily strife. Lately, can't tell if it's daylight or night. Fog's crawling up streets and turnpikes. Oh Lord, I don't want these nightmares no more. Oh Lord.
That was Nightmares by Eddie Brewer. Eddie, tell me a little bit about that song. I believe that's going to be your next release, right?
Yeah. So that is a song that I wrote. I wrote that one and another song called Where the Buffalo Roam. And in Nightmares, I decided to do solo with vocals and guitar, because one of my favorites is Hank Williams. And I recorded it over at Jeremy McDonald's studio, Hot Damn.
Hot damn indeed.
Yeah, he's it's all analog.
Vintage
stuff. With the Atomic Rangers, we've been recording there. And another group with Stella Martinez, and actually my friend Ciano Mays, Lucky Mays, he was doing some vocal harmonies, and Jeremy was too, with a group that's called the Pinewood Hearts that we started, that's kind of like a little acoustic harmony group. And just with the solo song, I just think it's nice to just be able, like Towns Van Zandt, to just talk about some personal stuff. I mean, like, I've had a lot of issues in my past, and a lot of stuff comes up regularly. And so that was one, it was just a weird week of just mental stuff. And I was like, well, what do when you got a bunch of mental stuff? You know, it's like, write a song. And, so that one and Where the Buffalo Roam kind of just came out almost effortlessly, because there's just a lot to play with that week.
How recent is this song then? When did you write it?
2 months ago.
Okay, and we're in October right now, so August?
Yeah, I wrote it in about August, yeah. And then, you know, and me and... yeah, and so, I mean, it's just cool. I like the different forms of recording, too. Like, we, me and the Despots, we recorded over at Third Eye, which was all digital. And that is, and it, digital definitely is really, really cool. David McRae is, like, he's amazing. And it's just cool having the variety of the analog, too, that's accessible in New Mexico. It's really a blessing. That you can go record with David and get these awesome digital tracks, because he's like a game 100%, just a badass person. And then, you know, you got Jeremy McDonald, and he's just, you know, he's a purist in the best way possible. Mm-hmm. And so being able to go to this like 1950s equipment and record, and that's what I recorded on with Nightmares, and you can hear the difference. It's weird. You can hear the difference between digital and analog, and I love them both. They both have their place in the world, mm-hmm. for sure. And but they're just it was just a great process, and we're still recording at both of those places. Like the Manic episodes, my jazz group just came out with a song called Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde that we're releasing in October, and Nightmares is being released in October too. And working on some stuff with the Pinewood Hearts and releasing that. So just trying to keep that constant rhythm of releasing new things and keeping people entertained.
You ready for the big question? The Go. Final question.
The final question.
Summarize what music means to you in less than 20 seconds.
Music is an expression of my existence.
That's good. Well, Eddie, I appreciate you coming out this evening. It's only 5 minutes away from midnight while we're recording.
Oh, cool.
And I appreciate you actually coming out here after doing a rehearsal with the Despots and working hard. It's always good having you over here. So thank you very much.
Hey, thank you, Craig. Appreciate it.